Hello everyone and welcome to tutorial number 26 in a series of video tutorials for Java programming. Don't forget to click on the subscribe button and click on the bell icon as well to stay up to date with every tutorial I upload on my channel. In the last tutorial, I discussed about final methods, final classes, interfaces and packages. So if you want to learn these concepts, if you are interested in these concepts, then you can go and watch tutorial number 25. So in this tutorial, I'm going to talk about the certain concepts. Okay, first of all, I'm going to talk about the finalize method. Actually, I have been planning to discuss this concept for a very long period of time, but in every video I miss out. So first of all, I'll be discussing this concept. Then after that, we'll be discussing about these other concepts. Okay, so let's get started. Let us see whether we can discuss all these concepts. Otherwise, if we miss out on any one or two concepts, then we will be discussing it in the next tutorial. So now let's get started. First of all, we are going to discuss the finalize method. As I said earlier, this finalize method, it is defined in the object class. And this class tutorial, it is going to extend from object. So if I try to write finalize here, okay, it is not going to work because actually finalize, it is not a static method. So because that's the way you are able to override that. So you can simply write new tutorial, then after that finalize, okay? But actually it is a deprecated method, okay? It is a deprecated method and it is going to throw an exception, unhandled exception, java.lang.throwable. So let's, first of all, let us, create that method. So the return type for that method is protected, then void, then after that finalize, okay? So this is a, a overwritten method. So in this case, you can see here that this is a overwritten method. So if I click on this, or if I, hover on this, it is showing it is override the method which is present in object. So now right now, if I click on this thing, then, it is going to redirect me to that particular, function which exists in object.java. Okay, so now you can see that protected, void, finalize, it is throwing throwable. Okay, so this is that particular method which I am trying to override over here. Okay, and now what I am going to do, I am going to, call this method basically. So now, how this function is going to work is, this function is called, whenever, the Java is, running the garbage collector, of whenever the a particular object is about to be garbage collected or it is about to be destroyed, this finalize method is going to get called. So for example, first of all, let me create two or three objects. So tutorial t equals new tutorial, then after that I'm just going to create two more copies of this. Okay, so then after that I just need to rename it. So I'm going to create a T1 and I'm going to rename this to T2. All right. So now what I'm going to do, I'm just going to put T equals to null. After putting T equals to null, I'm going to manually call the garbage collector. Okay. You can even manually call the garbage collector. So there are two ways to do this. Either you need to, call the static method of, a static method named GC, okay, of the system class. All right, so this is a public static void GC. So this is a GC, it is a static method which is defined in java.lang.system. So this is one of the ways to do the things. Okay, so now I am going to simply write here that destroyed object. Something like that. I'm just giving in one kind of message, okay, that this finalize method is called. Okay, so I can even change it to finalize method is called. All right, so let me do that instead, because ultimately this finalize method, it is not going to destroy the object, that is going to be done by the garbage collector only. Okay, but it is this thing, it is going to indirectly call the finalize method. But one thing which you need to remember is that this thing does not always happen. Okay, So right now, if I press the run button, it is possible that this method is called. It is even possible that this method is not called. This method is not always called by the garbage collector. So it depends. So don't get shocked that if this thing does not get called always. So let us wait for the execution to complete. So, okay, it is taking a bit of time. It is passing. All right. Okay, so we can see here that the finalize method is getting called. Okay, so that is how this thing is going to work. Okay, t becomes null. Now, what will happen if I remove t equals null and if I try to run the garbage collector once again? It is not going to do anything because t is not become null here. So if I use and it is also possible that it is not calling this finalize method. So if I try to run it once again, then it is showing that particular statement. Okay, there is another way to call the garbage collector, and that is to use runtime. Okay, runtime dot get runtime dot gc. Okay, so basically you can use any one of this method. You can either call this one or you can call this one to manually call the garbage collector. But however, I am just showing you how to manually call the garbage collector only because I'm explaining this finalize method here. Otherwise, usually you don't need to call the garbage collector either manually. Okay, so because garbage collection is automatic in Java, so you don't need to do it manually. It is not necessary. So now what I'm going to do, I'm going to put all the variables to null. So when I one thing you need to remember is whenever I'm putting a particular variable to null, all right, in that case, after that, if I call the garbage collector, okay, then after that, this finalize method will call. Then after that, it is going to destroy this particular object. Okay, so you can see here that now this finalize method here, why it is getting called three times. The reason behind that is that I am destroying three objects here. Okay, I am destroying this t object, then I am destroying t1, and I am destroying t2 as well. So that is the reason why it is working like that. All right, so this is all about the finalize method. Okay, so whenever I am trying to destroy an object, if I need to manually call this, okay, this thing will not get executed if I don't call this. If I simply write it like this, if I make this garbage collector line as a comment, then this finalize method will not get executed. I need to manually call it. And it is not necessary that this always happens. This method is always called. It is not necessary, even though it is getting called here. It is not necessary. Like now you saw right now, I have removed this comment, but it is not calling this finalize method. Okay, so it is not necessary that it is going to call it every time. Sometimes it may get called, sometimes it may not get called. The reason why it is like that is because this method, it does not guarantee that, it is not going to guarantee that the particular garbage collector is going to get executed. So because of this reason, finalize method does not always get executed. All right. So then after that, I'm going to talk about nested classes. So let us get started with that right away. Now, nested classes is nothing but a class within a class. So if you remember earlier, in the very third tutorial, I told you that, you can make this class as only public. You cannot write anything else before this. You cannot make it as private. Okay, that is not going to work. And you cannot make it as protector also. So, I played with this in the third tutorial also, and I played it once again here. So, but however, in a nested classes, you can, write public also if you want. Like, for example, I'm going to, create another class inside this tutorial. So, this is the inner class. Okay. This is the inner class. Now, this inner class, what this inner class is going to do is that, you know, I can, you know, change the access modifier. I can make this as private. It is not going to give any error. It is not giving any error. It is not showing any, you know, red icon over here. And I can make this protected as well. So it is not going to give any error. And another thing which you might have noticed here is, you know, this keyword IntelliSense, okay, which is showing suggestions, it is, you know, showing private also. But here it is not going to show private. Okay, so you can see right here it is not showing private. It is showing only public. It is not showing protected also. So that is the thing which you need to remember. You know, nested classes, they can be private, they can be public, they can be protected. And all the rules for the access specifiers, you know, is going to get followed. And I already mentioned what are the rules which are going to follow. So here I'm going to create one method. Let us say I'm going to create one method, public void, you know, method. All right. Then after that, I'm simply going to, you know, system.out.println. I'm going to write calling method of inner class. All right. So, sorry about that. It hung up a little. Okay, I was, you know, typing even though it was not responding. So now the thing is, I want to call this particular method. So how do I do that? Okay, since I am already in the tutorial class, I simply need to write inner. Okay, then in equals to new inner. Okay. But it is not going to, this cannot be referenced from a static context. Okay. Wait a second. Okay. New tutorial dot inner. Now, this is the thing which you need to, you know, keep in mind. Okay. New tutorial dot inner. But this is also not working. Tutorial dot this cannot be referenced from a static context. Okay, let's do one thing. Let us create the object of tutorial outside the static method equals to new tutorial. All right. Then after that, let us create the object inner in equals to t1 dot inner. T1 dot inner. Okay, so now I need to write a new t1 dot inner, but I don't think that's going to work. That is not going to work. Non-static field it is, so I'm going to make this as static. Okay, so obviously new t1 dot inner, again it's creating the same error. New t1 dot inner. Well, this is I did not expect this thing. Let me do one thing. Let me create the class object here itself. Inner in equals to new inner. Okay. Let us forget about all those things. In a static method, you need to create the method properly. So, in dot method, and again this has to be static. And again, it's going to create the same problem. It cannot be referenced from a static context. All right, let's do one thing. I'm just going to make this non-static, and I'm just going to create object of tutorial. Dot in dot method. Okay, finally we managed it. So now if I press the run button, then it is going to show calling method of inner class. So actually, one thing which you need to keep in mind is you cannot reference this from a static context. Okay, that's the reason why it's not working. All right, so that is the reason why it's not working. I don't know, actually. I think I created a new tutorial dot inner again it's creating the same error here. The tutorial make inner static. Okay, you need to make the static. If you make the static, then it is going to work. Okay, that's the issue actually. Okay, I got it. I don't know how, you know, how I made it so stupid. See, this is a non-static class. Okay, so I'm sorry about that. I'm extremely sorry about that. Tutorial t equals to new tutorial. Okay, obviously it is a non-static class, right? So t dot inner tutorial dot inner equals to new t dot, wait a second, I need to define a t1 something. I need to define new tutorial dot inner. No, that's not going to work. You need to make this static. That's the only way out. Okay, you need to make this as static. That is the only way out. Nothing else is going to work. T dot inner is it is going to give the same problem only. T dot inner, it is going to make it as tutorial dot inner only. So you need to make it as static. So you need to keep this thing in mind whenever you're trying to create a nested object of a nested class. You need to keep this thing in mind that how to create the object of the inner class. You need to always be careful. Okay, so either create object here, like I've created object here. Otherwise, you need to make this static. The problem is arising only because of the static context. Okay, since it is non-static, it is not able to access that particular class. Okay, that's why the problem is arising. So if this is static, then you need to make this static. Okay, so then after that, you can clearly write here t1 equals to new tutorial the r dot inner. That is very easy to write it like this. But if you remove static here, then this thing is not going to work actually, because then it is showing that tutorial dot this cannot be referenced from a static context. Okay, so this is a lesson for me also, and this is a lesson for you also, whosoever is going to watch this particular tutorial, that you need to make this as static. Okay, so then after that, variable length arguments. So that is how we create the object of the nested class. Then after that, the problem is only arose because I was trying to create object in the static main method. The problem will not come if I'm trying to create object over here, public void. Let us create a method named display. Okay. Then after that, if I create that public class or a private class inner, okay, I'm just going to create the object. I'm not going to do anything else. Inner, okay, inner in equals to new inner. You can specify like this also. You don't even need to write tutorial over here. It is not giving any errors. You don't even need to write tutorial here. Okay, so it is not necessary actually, but if you want, you can write it, but it is not necessary. You can even shorten it. Okay, so see here, it is not giving any error because this is a non-static, this is a non-static method. So this is not giving any error. It was creating problem only because this was a static method. Okay, if I try to copy the same thing and if I write it here, it is going to create a problem. Okay, so you need to be careful if you are trying to access in a static method. Okay, so then after that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about variable length arguments, and in the next tutorial you start with the inheritance and all the other concepts. All right, so let us just talk about variable length arguments and that ambiguity. So first of all, I'm going to create a variable length method. So public void let us say display. Okay, I'm going to display all the, you know, methods, all the parameters which are I'm passing here, int I. Okay, now because this is accepting dot dot dot, what is going to happen? It is going to print out all the elements which are present in this array. And remember, this I, it is an array. So how do I call this method? Obviously, this is a void display. This is a non-static method. So first of all, I am converting it to static. Then after that, I am going to call display. Then it is going to be very easy. One thing you need to remember is that this display, it can accept even zero parameters. You can see right here, it is accepting zero parameters. This is only giving a warning. Okay, it is not giving any errors. And after that, let us say I am writing, 10 values here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, you can write whatever you want to write here. And you can even specify 20 parameters here. But for example, just as an example, I am specifying 10 parameters. Then after that, I am just going to print out int, I cannot use I, int ji. Then system.out.println I. Sorry, not ij. Okay. So let me press the run button and it is going to print out all 10 numbers. Now, why I am able to use this is because this I, it is an array. All right. This I, it is an array. So because of this reason, I am able to use this. So it is printing out all 10 numbers. Now, the beauty of this, variable length argument is that, I can keep on, appending, arguments here. And I just need to press the run button. I don't need to make any modifications in the code in this function. And it will print out all the elements. As I said earlier, this is the, powerful nature of the for each loop. All right. So this is how that particular method is going to work. Now I am going to show you, how the ambiguity comes into the picture. So public static, I'm going to avoid display. So I'm going to override this method. I'm going to make this as boolean I. Okay, so it is not going to give any errors because this is a method overriding, and as I said in the tutorial itself, you can override the methods, different parameter types. Okay, here I'm using integer type, here I'm using boolean. Now, if I try to call this method by using only display, then it is going to give an error. And you can see right here, it is giving an error. Because now if I hover over this, it is saying ambiguous method call, both tutorial int. Okay, tutorial int means this thing, int I. Okay. Both display int and display boolean, both of them are matching, because as I showed you just a couple of minutes ago, this particular method, it accepts zero parameters. So obviously this method also, it is going to accept zero parameters. So that is the reason why it is not, this ambiguity is going to come into the picture. So if I write 5 here, then the ambiguity will go away because this method is getting called, and you can see the color of this text has changed to yellow. That means this method is getting called. If I'm making this as true, then this particular method will get called. Okay, so you need to be extremely careful if you're overriding this those methods which have variable length arguments, because you cannot pass a zero arguments. If you try to pass zero arguments, it will give an error. However, if you pass even just one argument, a minimum of one argument, then the error will get removed. Okay, so that's all I'm going to talk about in this tutorial. We have discussed about finalize method, nested and inner classes, variable length arguments, and the ambiguity in variable length arguments. In the next tutorial, we'll be talking about inheritance, the super keyword, super class reference, a method of overriding, etc. So if you like this particular tutorial, then don't forget to like, share and subscribe. And if you have any kind of questions, then don't forget to post in the comment section below. And I will see you in the next tutorial. So till then, bye.